Good morning. Great to see you today. Thanks for being here. We're going to get started. Before we engage in our worship music, I want to take care of some of the announcements this morning. We have the Actuses with us today, and so we're going to get in there. So we're going to do things in a little bit different order this morning. So let me just highlight a few of the key announcements that you need to really know about. Take the opportunity to read the bulletin so you can stay engaged with all the other things. But here's a couple of the keys. There we go. Looking for my bulletin. I lost it. See if I can not fall over. Here we go. Saturday, men's quarterly breakfast here at New Hope Church. And our special guest, this guy is an ex, he's a Navy guy, deep sea diver, weapons specialist, and got a great testimony to share with us next Saturday. So that's at 8 o'clock. Coffee's on, ready to go by 7:30. And if you have any questions, see Mark at us about that. We would love to have all you men here for that. Next Sunday, 1 week earlier than normal, next Sunday is our Christmas musical and message Sunday, all right? And so the choir, Tim Kepler, going to be here. Beautiful, beautiful job with music. And so invite your friends or family, neighbors to come join us for that special Sunday. But please notice the change in time for next Sunday. All three services will have the Christmas music and message. So the 8 o'clock service will be meeting in here. So we have slightly changed times that day. 8, 9:30, and 11 o'clock. All right, so those are the service times for next Sunday, 8, 9:30, and 11 o'clock. A week from Tuesday is the Primetimers Luncheon, and it's the Christmas season lunch. You don't want to miss it. This afternoon at 1:15, we're going to have a church-wide meeting to propose to you the 2017 budget. Talked about it briefly last week. The good news and the bad news is this. The bad news is we're asking for a little bit more than we did last year. The good news is that's less than you've already given this year. Okay, so that's the less, more lifestyle of New Hope Church, all right, for next year. So come and join us for that. And I am so excited. I'm just going to tell it to you right now. You'll be able to see the numbers when you come this afternoon. We have given away this year 25.5% of what we have taken in to outside ministries, missions, and causes, all right? Not 10%, not 20%, 25%. So God bless you for your availability and for your generosity. Angel Tree gifts, those were to be brought back by today. If you go, call Janice. Her number's in here, all right? She'll tell you how to make those arrangements. But if you brought them today, they're in your car. Deliver them in the pavilion. There's tables out there. They'll be received and prepared for delivery in the next week or so. Let's see. I took care of that. Outside also in the pavilion, you will find representatives from the junior high and high school group and the Shasky family. And you can purchase bags of Shasky nuts out there, flavored, unflavored. They're terrific. And it's a fundraiser for our kids for camp. So if you need some holiday refreshments around your house and you like almonds or walnuts, they got maple bacon nuts out there. Does that not sound, bacon makes everything good, all right? So that little maple, that's almost like having a pancake and a nut, all right? And so they're really, really good. So check that out. They would love to have you there today. I'm dropping things. You have inside your bulletin, and I will talk more about this after the act to speak, but just have it ready. There is a card like this inside your bulletin. So just have it where you can get a hold of, and we're going to talk about that after the actus is shared. Let me highlight now some prayer requests that are not in your bulletin or some updates on a few things that are, and then right after that, we will have our morning tithes and offering. First of all, I want you to be remembering my cousin Debbie. Ever since the death of her mom, our Aunt Flo, that many of you knew, Debbie's health has been very, very poor. She's been in and out of the hospital, and right now she is in a care facility. So if you would be remembering Debbie Arnellis, I would appreciate that so very, very much. Larry Gallant, a former elder of our church, moved up to Shaver Lake. He's part of the Shaver Lake Community Church now. He is currently at the Heart Hospital. And Chick Passarella shared with me today that it appears that his days are very, very limited. So if you'd remember to pray for Pam and Larry Gallett and what their family is going through, I know they would appreciate that very much. Jay Brown, all right, not the governor, but the more important man in New Hope Church. He's going to be going the latter part of January for a unique surgery up out of Seattle, Washington. It's very, very new. Only a limited number of communities are doing it. Most of them are teaching hospitals, and his heart specialist here is going up and scrubbing in and learning the procedure so they can bring it back to this area. Briefly, how I can describe it is just like they go up your groin and put stents in. He's got 12 of them in him right now. All right, two went bad and they've replaced them. So I think the total's 14 he's had done. But anyway, bucket load of them. He's not a candidate for other kinds of surgery. So this is a new technique. They go up that same way, except they take this little pump, all right? And this pump gets installed right in kind of the middle of the heart, and it takes over for your heart. And so it continues to pump blood through your system. Well, your heart will stop during this procedure, but blood doesn't stop flowing because of this pump. And they're able then to do a Roto-Rooter job on those clogged arteries. And they have a special filter that catches all of that plaque that's lined up in there. And then you get a new lease on life without an extremely invasive surgery. And then that pump is pulled back out, and then it's destroyed. And it cost them $20,000 for one time and done, all right? But it's a pretty incredible device. And so I want you to be praying for Jerry and Sonny and their trip up there. And Shelly and I, we're anticipating going up because this is a kind of a big thing. And since it's so new and rare, we want to be alongside and support them. So continue to pray for them. Lorraine Blankenship has second and third degree chemical burns. And on her hand and foot. And so I want you to be praying for her. Right now it's pain control and pain management until there's enough healing that they can begin to make decisions on what to do next. So please be remembering to pray for Lorraine. That's Debbie and Sam's daughter. Diana Rood's been going through some health challenges, been to a special clinic down in San Diego that's giving some direction. So pray for them as they go through these next step. Cami Molinari was to have had surgery on Friday, and it got, because of court duty, for a doctor, it got pushed till probably tomorrow. So be praying for that pending surgery. There have been a lot of losses in families, death. And I'm always careful not to say loss too often, because for like Lucy Best, who went home to be with the Lord about midnight Thursday night, all right, early Friday morning. Been in Heinz Hospice since Monday of this past week. And that's not a loss, that's a gain. She knew exactly where she was going. She was prepared for that and anticipating it. I do not have any information about services yet, but we will keep you posted through announcements or through the email once we get a definite on that. It's not Kent Adams. It's Peggy Adams' brother, Kent. And I just went blank on Kent's last name. It begins with an M. Thank you. Millar, M-I-L-L-A-R. Kent Millar. Passed away unexpectedly this past week, all right, in his 60s. And so those services are pending as well. Frank Freitas, a service that we have tomorrow afternoon from our own church, Pat Roberson, her husband Gene, passed away last week. And so just be remembering all of these that we have mentioned in our bulletin that have going through some losses here during the holiday season. So we don't want you to forget those. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. And then right after we pray, I'm going to reintroduce to you, all right, for those who haven't seen them yet, Matt and Shelley Actis. Okay? I know I'm going to say Mark or Addis, all right, somewhere in there, all right, before it's over. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your sufficiency in our lives. When we're sick, you are our encouragement and our hope. When we are well, you are our strength and our stability. You want to be the director of our thoughts and our actions. You want to be the giver of our dreams and visions, and you want to be the sufficiency for all that we face. And so we give thanks to you, the one who supplies all of our needs. And you supply those needs not based upon how much we deserve it, but Father, you provide those resources based upon the riches of glory. And so we give you thanks that that, Father, it's an unending supply of your sufficiency for our inadequacy. Father, we trust you with the needs of those who are experiencing sorrow and grief, and may the hope of Jesus Christ comfort them during these days. Father, for those that are going through physical challenges and there's either surgeries or procedures that are scheduled, may they experience that indescribable peace which you make available to us. And so we trust you for that in all these areas. For Matt and Shelley being with us today, we're so grateful for what you have done in and through them in the past. We're excited to hear about that, and we're also thrilled to know about what your plans for them in the future are. Thank you for having them home with us during this holiday season. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thank you. We commit all this to you in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. As most of you know, because we've been talking about it for several weeks now, Matt and Shelley are home. They got back in the States the first part of this week and arrived here in the home area on Friday. And we are so glad to have them in service today. You have opportunity to hear from them briefly this morning from each of them, see a couple of short videos. And then you also have the opportunity to come back between 2:30 and 5:30 this afternoon. There are going to be refreshments. There are going to be other videos. You're going to get to hear more extensively from them about what they've been doing and what God continues to plan to do through them in the years to come. So we hope you'll come back and join us at 2:30. A lot more time for Q&A and dialogue with them and rekindling friendships and relationships at that time. But it is our pleasure to have them here during our morning service. And so, Matt, I believe you're leading this off. And then I think I heard you say over in the other service, you saved the best for last. And so Shelley will follow you. So, Matt, great to have you. I believe this is the microphone they would love for you to use. And it is now on.
Good morning, New Hope.
Good morning, Matt.
Merry Christmas. It is such a joy to be home. We've been serving overseas for over 6 years now. And it's just, they don't celebrate Christmas quite like Americans do with all the Christmas carols, the decorations, and the lights. And so I think we only came home one time before during Christmas time to celebrate with you. And so it really is such a joy to be home. I'm not real thankful for the cold weather. I've been living on the equator for 6 years, and I like it there. First thing we did when we got off the plane was we went to the mall and buy some jackets. You may remember it's been about a year and a half that we were here, and we were home trying to raise support so we could transition from Colombia to Uganda, East Africa. And we felt that the Lord was placing on our hearts a call to go to teach pastors, to teach farming, and to teach vocational skills to girls. We asked the Lord, Lord, please go before us, and wow, was he there before us preparing the way in a really big way. And we're really excited to share with you today about how God has been making a difference and also how you, through your support of us, how you have been making a difference in the lives of those in Uganda. I have a short video of the work that we're doing, of the work that I'm doing in Colombia, the work that I'm doing in Uganda. And then afterward, we'll have Shelley, the best, saved for last, come up and share with you the work that the Lord has called her to do and what she foresees the Lord calling her to do next. It's really quite exciting. If we're ready on the video. She is known as the Pearl of Africa, rich in both soil types and weather patterns. Yet many of her people are starving, both physically and spiritually. Uganda, poor education and poor farming practices are the leading causes Ugandans face. Although the poorest village family owns at least some land, farmers will till the soil until it is infertile, then leave it and rent land somewhere else. Our Farming God's Way programs teach them how to better steward what God has already given them. Farming God's Way is a transformative farming technique that first introduces them to Christ, the creator of everything. Through biblical principles, farmers learn how to properly take care of the land and how to increase crop yields. Uganda,
a place where you can find Christian churches, yet very few qualified pastors. Fighting among church members and leaders, church splits, and a misunderstanding and misrepresentation of true Bible doctrine are all part of the Ugandan church today. My ministry is to come alongside pastors in a caring, discipling way, to show them the truth, to teach them the Bible, and to guide them to becoming a better man of God. Our pastors are making huge improvements, learning how to properly study their Bibles, find biblical values and truths, to learning how to guide their church members in attaining a deeper relationship with our Savior. Because of your partnership with us, communities can now feed themselves, both physically and spiritually. Thank you.
I want to be really honest with you. Sometimes when the Lord places things on our heart to go and do, we stop and we scratch our head a little bit and we say, "What are you up to, God?" I was raised on a ranch. My dad was an ag teacher, and I grew up knowing agriculture. I went to Fresno State, graduated with a degree in agricultural education, followed in my dad's footsteps, became an ag teacher, and the Lord just placed in both Shelley and I's hearts to go and become missionaries in Colombia. And to be honest with you, I was left scratching my head some, going, "Is this really God? Am I really the right person for this?" And we went to Colombia out of obedience, and the Lord told us to church plant. And through that period of time, I never used any agricultural background, experience that I had, knowledge that I had. We church planted and pastored a church for a couple of years. Then the Lord said, "Go to Uganda." And it left me scratching my head again, going, "Lord, what are you up to?" Now we can see how God fulfills his own words. Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." The Lord has been preparing me all my life for this exact ministry. And I feel it and I know it, and I just feel absolutely blessed to share with you today what the Lord is doing through our life. And I want to thank you for supporting us all of these years, being behind us 100%. And praying for us. Now the best for last, my wife Shelley would come up.
Good morning, New Hope. I hate to do this to my daughters, but I'm going to make them stand for just a moment. I didn't tell them I was going to do that, and we usually don't make them come up. But just in the year and a half, you can see how much these young ladies have grown and changed. I was just looking at pictures recently, especially of the twins, Chloe and Sophie, just how much they have changed in these last few years. So anyways, you can come by and give them a hug and a squeeze. It just warms my heart to be here, especially during this time. I just look at this church and I say, wow, what an amazing testimony of just God's love and his presence here. And so I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for loving us through these years. There's nothing better than being back amongst our New Hope family, where we feel just loved and uplifted and encouraged. So I just want to say thank you from the bottom of our hearts. A lot of people call these ministry reports or missionary reports, and I hate that term because that sounds really boring. I like to think of it more as a celebration of what God has done through his servants and through you here at New Hope in partnership with us as we partner with God and what he's doing in Uganda. And so it's a pretty incredible thing to watch him work through that, and that's what we get to do. We get to see it on the front line, but we get to come back and share that with you, and so we're just so privileged. Over the last 6 years, God has been knitting Matt and my hearts together for ministry as a husband and wife team, But obviously, he has given us different skills and talents to use to further his kingdom. And so while Matt has been pouring into the lives of men, building up godly men to serve their communities better, he's given me a burden for the women, and specifically young girls in the village, as we have come to find out in our time there that really they're some of the most vulnerable of Uganda are these village girls. Meeting with moms in the village, I would hear a common theme throughout that they wanted something for their uneducated daughters. And having daughters myself, my heart went out to them to see their daughters living lives of practical slavery, as Tim said earlier. I hate to use that word, but it truly is pretty descriptive of their lives. So as I heard story after story of these village girls, oftentimes they're married off at 13 or 14 years old when they're still young girls themselves. The bride price is still very much alive and well in Uganda, and poor families will give their daughters at very early ages in order to collect the bride price, and that gives them more time and sustainability. And so as early as 13 or 14, they're marrying off their daughters. Very soon after that, they're expected to start a family, because in Africa, having a large family means you're blessed, even though if you don't know how you're going to feed them. And so we have girls that are, have 10, 12 kids. It's very common still in rural Africa. I also heard of stories of girls being abandoned by their husbands. We heard story after story of girls being married to husbands that have 2, 3, 4, up to 5 wives, as polygamy is widely practiced there in Uganda. And out of this burden, I just felt like there had to be something more. There had to be something more for these girls. I wanted these girls to experience a second chance, as we're given a second chance in Christ. I wanted these girls to have an experience feeling dignity and feeling worth. I wanted to give back a small part of their childhood that had been stolen from them. So out of this burden, New Life Skills Center was born. It's a one-year program where we disciple and we mentor young girls. They're all dropouts between the ages of 13 and 17 years old. They have between a fourth grade and a seventh grade educational level. We mentor and we disciple them while teaching them basic math, English, health, and Bible. We want to give them the life skills that they can use for a better future. That's the first part of our year. That's the first 6 months. And then the second 6 months, we shift a little bit and we are teaching them life skills such as tailoring, hairdressing, and also farming using Matt's Farming God's Way program, because most of them will at some time be farmers. We're giving them business skills as well. And we opened the doors of our very first school just recently, August 1st, where we are pouring into the lives of 17 girls. It has been, God says that he will bless beyond our wildest imaginations. And going into a community and building those relationships, you're not sure that they're going to trust us with their girls. I mean, they're precious. We're not exactly sure how that's all going to go. And so God has just continued to show us the way to bless the work. You'll see in a moment in the video the impact in these girls' lives that has been made. And I just want to say it's a celebration, because that impact is largely in part because of you here at New Hope. We can't be there without you. So you are making a huge difference in the girls' lives. So I'll show you a quick video which expresses even better than I can the impact that's been being made and the difference that's being made in these girls' lives. I heard story after story of these girls. I tried to imagine my own daughters dropping out of school because we couldn't afford the school fees. I tried to imagine them being married at 14 or 15. I tried to imagine them being abandoned by their husbands
or their husbands taking on a second or third wife. But I simply couldn't. I heard the voiceless, I felt the powerless, and I saw their dismal futures. They needed a second chance at reaching their God-given potential. They needed to feel empowered by having tools and life skills for a brighter future. I knew that there had to be something more for these girls. Through all of this, New Life Skills Center was born. Each girl deserves not only to acquire life skills, but to know she is loved and that she is worthy, that she matters, and that there is a God who cherishes her. When they grasp these truths, they come alive. I tried to imagine doing this on my own, but I simply can't.
In the 8 o'clock service, Matt used a line that I want to use again in this service. Matt goes there with Farming God's Way, and he teaches the villagers how to produce food so that they can live by. And the other part of Matt's responsibility is he teaches and disciples pastors so the pastors can teach their congregations what they need to grow and live by. It's both nurturing the physical and the soul at the very same time. And then what Shelley is doing is literally pulling young girls, all right, out of what would appear to be, for no better word and an accurate description, out of slavery, and giving them an opportunity with education to have a much brighter future. And we have seen the difference that kind of education can make. And so here's the deal. They started that school. Let me back up. Most of you here know Matt and Shelley are from New Hope. They were from Clovis. They were from our church family. When they recognized the call that God put on their lives to go to the mission field. We are their primary, not their sole support, but we are their primary, as it ought to be, support out on the field. We literally share with them in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. This is our privilege as well as responsibility to be engaged with them. And so out of what's provided for them, for their monthly support, they started the first school for those 17 girls. Out of what we already give, which is for them, they have supplied for that. In order to take care of 20 girls for a year in that kind of educational program that they have set up, which involves discipleship as well, it costs about $10,000 for a year to take care of 20 girls. That is our goal today. God called them from us and sent them there to give them direction on what to do, and it's going to be our privilege to help make that possible. And some of you are saying, Tim, we've just helped, man, with Ivory Coast, all right, Folsom to Forgiven. Absolutely correct. But you know what? God has blessed us for it. And in fact, we just might get to 27% before December 31st gets here of what we get to give away. Here's the deal. I like to break things down into bite size. Do you realize if 100 people give $100, there's $10,000? There's going to be about 600 people here today. So if 1/6 of them would give $100, we do it. Now, I realize we might not have 100. So if we got 50 who do that, and we got another 100 who give 50, then we've done it. Okay, do you see how it can be done? Pull this card out. Now, at the same time, I would be thrilled to death if we raised $20,000. Because then they could do two schools. They can go to two villages and carry the same thing out. So I'm fully aware that there are probably a few people around who could give $5,000 or $10,000 just by themselves. So I don't want to limit you to giving just $100. Okay? You don't have to limit it to only 100, but 100 is doable for most of us, all right? You can go right now to Lowe's, and for $100, you can get a new heater to go on your patio that you'll use for 3.5 months, Or you can give $100, a great Christmas present, and you can change the life of a young lady for all eternity. Which is a better gift? Which is a better use of your money? Now, have you ever had to buy a gift for somebody and you say, what am I going to get for them? They got everything they want or need. Do you ever do that? They're saying, yeah, that's true. So here's a way you can do that. If you choose to give, if you take this card, you fill it out, and you put on here, yeah, I'm going to give $100, or I'm going to give $50, or I'm going to give $10,000. All right, here's what you can do. You can not only get a tax deduction out of that, but you can also give a gift, because they have these beautiful cards here, and they're out on a table. All right, the welcome card, or ask us if you don't find them, and you can hang this on your tree, and come Christmas, the person that you didn't know what to buy for, you could say, look what I did in your name. And on this card, it says, thank you for making a difference in the life of a village girl. Generously donated in your honor to give Ugandan girls a second chance. So here's their gift. Isn't that cool? I love that idea. So here's the deal. At the end of the service, we're going to have a second offering. And some of you are going to say, Tim, I knew the actors were going to be here today, but I didn't come prepared to do anything. Great, take this card with you, pray about it, bring it back next Sunday. But some of you, you already know what you can do, all right? Some of you already know. Some of you, you were prayed about it before they got here. So fill the card out, put it and or your gift in the offering bag at the end of the service, or take it home, and you can do this. We want to take care of this by the end of January, okay? So if you make a pledge, it's a pledge that you can do in December and January. Because they're going to be launching a new school very quickly after they get back. They'll be here till December 31st, so if you bring these back by next week, we'll be able to put a tally together and let them know what has been raised while they were here. Does that make sense? If you write a check today, or if you write a check next week, make it to New Hope Church, but on the memo line or on the envelope, write Hope 58. And then we will be sending all of that directly to them. Hope 58 is their NGO, all right, that they have started so they can do additional ministries besides what they're already doing there. And if you don't know what an NGO is, Google it. It will explain it faster than I can at this moment. But it's a nonprofit organization for doing work like they are doing. All right? Clear as a bell? Any questions you have about this? Okay, that's good. You're motivated to share and to give at this very moment. The gift of Christmas is always about sacrifice. And so all of us together, small sacrifices make gigantic differences in the lives of others. Hey, turn to Psalm 145 for a few minutes. Not going to be a full-on sermon today. All right, Psalm 145. Verses 1 through 5. 1 through 7. During our study in the Psalms during this past year, I've noticed that there are a few words that are used frequently in these hymns that we don't use very often today. I don't know if they are words that have become meaningless. I don't know if they are words that we simply don't know how to use properly. Or I don't know if we have just neglected the value of some key words, as they are descriptive words about God and His work towards us. They're illustrated again in Psalm 145. I will exalt you, my God the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. And every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and worthy of praise. And you just did a bang-up job of that today. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend your works to another. Are we? Are we? Are we sharing with the next generation the greatness, the awesomeness? Who carries the title in our culture today of king? Anybody want to guess? Okay, when I was a kid growing up, it was King Elvis. He was the king, all right? Who carries that king today? I mean, that word today? LeBron James. They call him King James. He's probably never read it at all, but he goes by the title, all right? King James. We assign terms of royalty to rock stars and basketball players who in a decade or two, they will be obsolete. What we'll do next is name our dogs after them. The bosses have a dog named Elvis, okay? So I could resist that. But are we telling the next generation about the greatness, the awesomeness of who God the Creator, of who God the Savior, of who God the Redeemer is? We're teaching our kids how to balance their bank accounts, maybe. We're teaching them how to get an education so they can be successful in life. But are we telling the next generation what they need to know of eternal value? One generation will commend your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. Do we tell our kids what God is doing in our lives? They will speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. There's one of the words we don't use much anymore, majesty. And I will meditate on your wonderful works. They will tell of the power of your awesome deeds, and I will proclaim your great works. They will celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. Some of the words that we find throughout the Psalms are words like master, meditate, majesty, and mercy. What do all those words have in common? M&Ms, yeah. So these are the M&Ms of the scripture, all right? You and I should crave M&Ms. I should have bought some bags of M&Ms and thrown them out to the audience, all right? Just as an illustration. Man, we need some M&M in our life. I don't have time to talk about all these, but at least one, maybe two I want to highlight. Let's first focus on this word majesty, majestic. We sing songs about the majesty of God, but do we really focus on the majesty of God? The word majestic is used minimally 13 times in the scriptures. Here's a couple of examples. Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in glorious deeds, doing wonders? Psalm 8, verse 9 says, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all of the earth. We sing that as a hymn, and we're simply quoting scripture when we do. 2 Peter 1:17 says, for when he, Christ, received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by majestic glory, when he said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Majesty is used at least 44 times in the scriptures. 1 Chronicles 29 says, yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and on the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord. You are exalted high above all. Psalm 145:5 that we just read to you, on the glorious splendor of your majesty, on your wondrous works, I will meditate. I'm assuming that some of you watched football yesterday. Alabama played. Florida scored the first touchdown. They looked awesome. But in the presence of greatness, like Alabama, Florida was crushed. And there are probably a few plays that you've talked about since you watched that game yesterday. Clemson and, Virginia Tech playing. I mean, they're trying to figure out who the Final Four, who the best are in college football. And there was this battle back and forth between these two teams. And we talk about some awesome plays. Some of you in here, you are Dallas Cowboy fans, and you are riding a wave you haven't been on in decades. Okay? Some of you are Raiders. Some of us have become Raiders fans. Okay? Never thought I would say that. I mean, I thought I was using profanity when I said Raiders in the past. And now you know I've become one because I now have a pillowcase with the Raiders on it. All right? I can rest my head while I'm watching the game on the Raiders. All right? Why? Simply because of the greatness of Derek Carr on offense and their middle linebacker on defense. And so we get caught up in the greatness of human endeavors that if it weren't for instant replay, we would forget in a matter of hours or days. How often do you and I replay to the next generation the greatness of God? In this 21st century, we are very good at emphasizing just one part of the character of God. You see, what often happens is, I think there are twin truths that when we talk about God, we need to always keep them connected. And that is the majesty of God and His desire to be engaged personally in a relationship with us. This great, majestic, incredible, awesome God wants to have personal relationships with us. During my generation as a pastor, we've made a transition from the previous generation. And I think it was good and it's bad. I grew up being preached and taught to about the majesty of God. And that God was so great and awesome, it's hard for us to believe or comprehend. And God was so awesome that it almost carried with it. And I was so sinful that it was like God wanted nothing to do with me. So we taught the one side of the truth, and that was His majesty. But it was so incredible that it was like I could never, ever be in His presence. And so there was a shift then. And more of us in my generation began to preach this God became very personal at Christmas. And this incredible God wants to live in you. And we've brought God down to a personal level that we have lost the majesty of His greatness. You know, you've heard me tell the story about playing golf with Duke Snider. There was a time in my life that I said, man, I would never, ever get to play golf. I would never get to sit down and have a conversation with the likes of a Mickey Mantle or a Willie Mays or a Duke Snider. Once we did, I'm still somewhat awed by it, but you know what? I found out Duke puts his pants on the same way I do. I found out on a golf course, Duke had a slice, okay? He didn't play a perfect game. Much better than I could play, but it wasn't a perfect game, all right? He had some, all of a sudden, he wasn't as great as I thought he was because he got real personal with me. I think the church, maybe we've done the same thing with God. We've brought Him down to such a personal level that we have lost His divinity and His majesty. And what God desires from us is to understand both. That this awesome, incredible, amazing, majestic God wants to come live in me. And let's not lose sight of His majesty as we become personally engaged with Him. God's power is not limited. His presence is not limited. His knowledge is not limited. This awesome God is eternal. He's almighty. He is infinite. There are examples from His creation that remind us of that. The sun radiates more energy in 1 second than you and I have used since the beginning of civilization. In 1 second, a typical quasar throws out enough energy to supply all the Earth's electrical needs for billions of years. We are beginning to harness a small part of that with what we call solar energy. But God has created more than enough to supply our needs. How? According to the richness of His majesty. We often do things to scale. Remember as a kid making models? And they would say, to scale. In other words, the tires were the right size to go with the body of the car, just like it was a full-size car. We sometimes have architects draw plans on a piece of paper to scale, 1 to 10, 1 to 100 scale. Do you know that what God created, man cannot put to scale? Do you realize what scale would be like if you tried to put to scale the universe? If you took the earth and you made it a 1-inch ball, do you know how many miles you would have to go away from that 1-inch ball to stay to appropriate scale before you could have the first star? 51,000 miles away to be scale. Can you comprehend that? Do you know how far it is to North Carolina? Just about 3,000 miles from Fresno. If you get on I-40 out of Barstow, which is where it begins, there's a sign there, all right, that says North Carolina, 2,462 miles. Okay? Now, that's from here to the other side of the U.S., and yet If you had to do to scale the earth, the size as a one-inch ball, the first star would be 51,000 miles away. That's pretty incredible, and yet God is the one who did that. How can you and I comprehend the majesty of God? Two things I would suggest to you. One, we need to remove thoughts that limit the greatness of the majesty of God. As Christians, we need to stop saying things like, can't do it. As Christians, we have to stop saying things like, that's impossible. You must be crazy. Let's take a small example. Matt and Shelley are here in December to raise money. Some of you are saying, Tim, $10,000? Are you crazy? You think we could do that in one Sunday? No, I don't. But I know a God who can. I know an awesome, majestic, incredible God who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, and he owns more than 1,000 hills those cattle feed on. I know a God who can. And I know that what we have to learn to do is stop looking at each other for our answers of yes or no, and we need to start looking at God. And we need, there was an old phrase that, it kind of went out when I was a kid, but I remember a few of my grandfather's friends occasionally still saying it. When you would ask if they were going to do something, they would always say, if God wills, if it's God's will. And as often, we sometimes say things and they become repetitive and they tend to lose their meaning. But in that culture, in that generation, remember, these were depression babies. They knew what it was to lose everything. They knew what it was to God to meet their needs and the loss of everything. And so they learned how to say, you know what, if that's God's will, I'm open to it. So we need to remove the thoughts that limit the majesty of God. A.W. Tozier said, worship is to feel in our heart and express in an appropriate manner a humbling but delightful sense of admiring awe, astonished wonder, and overpowering love in the presence of the most ancient mystery, that majesty which philosophers used to call the first cause, but who we now call our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Go to the book of Job sometime, read chapters 38 to the end of the book, and discover what Job discovered at the end of his life when he said, I despise myself and I repent in dust and ashes. Have you come to a point in your life that you are so awed of God's majestic glory that you are prepared to repent in dust and ashes? It's hard to get people to come forward to an altar to repent, much less in dust and ashes. Well, the second step to get the proper comprehension of the greatness of God is to make a comparison with powers and forces which we regard as great. Okay? To get the proper perspective of the greatness of God is to make comparisons with powers and forces which we regard as great, and then we will discover they're not so great. In reality, if we compare God to anything or anyone other than himself, it is a feeble exercise. Go read Isaiah chapter 40, verses 12 through 25, sometime this afternoon or this week. The verse 25 of that chapter says, to whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One. In one of his letters to Erasmus, Martin Luther, the Reformation theologian, said, your thoughts of God are too human. Your thoughts of God are too human. Have you had an unhumanly thought of God lately? I think we need to ask him for one. The other word I want to throw out at you in our last few minutes today is the word mercy. Mercy. Webster's Dictionary says that mercy is a blessing that is an act of divine favor or compassion, a fortunate circumstance, a compassionate treatment of those who are in distress. Mercy, giving to those what they don't deserve. There was a Prussian king, his name was Frederick the Great, who was touring a Berlin prison. And when he entered, the prisoners fell on their knees before him to proclaim their innocence except for one of the inmates. He remained on a chair, silent. Frederick walked over to him and said, why are you in here? The man replied, armed robbery, your majesty. Are you guilty? Yes, indeed, I deserve every bit of my punishment. Frederick then summoned the jailer and ordered him, please release this guilty wretch at once. I will not have him kept in this prison where he will corrupt all the fine, innocent people who occupy it. Mercy. Mercy granted because of honesty. Mercy has a broad spectrum of meanings. There are several hospitals in the country, one in Bakersfield that I know of called Mercy Hospital. It suggests that inside you'll find compassion and treatment for the sick, the injured, and those in physical pain. We as a congregation are responding to the distresses by engaging in mission trips to Uganda and to the Ivory Coast. Small groups from our fellowship are engaged with the rescue mission to help those with great need. Many involved with prison fellowship, going behind prison walls, helping with Angel Tree, helping at Heinz Hospice those who have needs. You see, because today we can easily identify a world constantly filled with misery, we will never lack the opportunity to show mercy. Majesty. Understanding the majesty of God, we will learn how to be merciful to one another. Our God is majestic and he is worthy of our praise. And when we become the recipients of his grace and we become the recipients of his mercy, we will want to pass on to others that same kind of mercy. Amen. Christian writer and commentator Warren Wiersbe tells about a town where a horse bolted away and ran away with a wagon carrying a little boy. Seeing the child in danger, a young man risked his life to catch the horse and stop the wagon. The child who was saved that day grew up to become a lawless man. And one day he stood before a judge to be sentenced for a very serious crime. The prisoner recognized the judge as the man who years before had saved his life. So he pled for mercy on the basis of that experience. But the words that day from the bench silenced his plea. "Young man," the judge said, "that day years ago, I was your savior. And I was able to show you mercy. But today I am your judge. And I must pronounce sentence." Jesus Christ has said by his actions from his birth to the cross that he wants to extend mercy to rebellious sinners. During this long period of grace from then till now, Jesus can say, "With mercy, I want to be your Savior. I want to forgive you today." But there will be a day when Jesus will say, "I am no longer your Savior. I am your judge." A majestic God filled with great mercy wants to relieve you and me from the consequences of judgment. And when we've been relieved from the consequences of judgment, this majestic God wants to come and live and demonstrate his life through ours by our acts of mercy to one another, to Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the world. From Clovis, Fresno, to behind prison walls, to across town at a mission, to around the world at places like Colombia and Doropo and Uganda. Have you been awed by God's majesty? Have you been humbled by his mercy? Does it make a difference in your life? Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we love you. Forgive us, Father, of having too human of thoughts about you. I pray that you'll find men and women and young people right here, whether they're 12, 15, 18, or 80, who can pray this prayer, "Lord, expand my mind to think greater thoughts about who you are." Because God, if I can have greater thoughts about who you are, I can have a greater understanding of you, who you have designed me to become. God, I want to be humbled by your majesty. I want to be changed by your mercy. And I want others to know about your great, majestic life and your wonderful offer of mercy. Father, I pray that in the quietness of human hearts at this very moment, men and women, young people are saying, Lord, I crave you, I desire you, I'm ready on the basis of truth to have a personal relationship with you. Lord Jesus, come live in my life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.